All right.
I'm going to explain to you how oxygen and carbon dioxide are transported in the blood.
You got me?
This is a big one.
First of all, the only place that gases are exchanged in the respiratory tract, in the alveoli, and the pulmonary capillary.
You got me?
So for oxygen, the two ways that oxygen is transported in the blood are bound to the iron in hemoglobin.
That's why blood is red.
So each hemoglobin molecule has four iron atoms. And each iron atom is capable of carrying one oxygen molecule.
This is the kicker. This is the important piece.
Each red blood cell has about 250 million molecules of hemoglobin.
So one red blood cell can carry a ton of oxygen.
Are you with me?
You got that.
So the best way, as a matter of fact, 98% of oxygen is transported in the iron
that's embedded in hemoglobin.
So anything that causes a drop in red blood cells in your body, anemia, bleeding, whatever, is going to decrease the amount of oxygen you can deliver to cells. The other way that's important, but not as substantial, is oxygen dissolved in plasma.
And oxygen dissolved in plasma is measured as a PO2.
You got me? Did I go through the values of PO2 inside the blood and in the cell?
Did I do that?
Okay, I did do that, right?
PO2 100 in the alveoli, right? I did that.
Okay. So the way oxygen is transported in the blood, the best way is bound to the iron on hemoglobin from a clinical standpoint.
If you work in a nursing home or a hospital and you put the little finger thing on the person, right?
What are you measuring?
Yeah, that's exactly right. So what you're doing is you're measuring the amount of oxygen bound to the iron on hemoglobin.
And normal is 96 to 98%.
So if you have 96 to 98% of your oxygen bound to the iron on hemoglobin through the little finger thing, then you are oxygenating your blood normally.
And that means, in order to get a saturation of red blood cells between 96 and 98, You have to have a PO2 in the alveoli between 80 and 100. And what's the normal PO2? 80 to 100.
Tell me you got that.
So anything that would cause you not to be able to get oxygen from the alveoli into the blood.
Say, for example, you have pulmonary edema, so you have fluid in your alveoli.
That's going to decrease the amount of oxygen that can get dissolved in the plasma, and that's ultimately going to decrease oxygen saturation of a red blood cell.
Say yes. You're with me following this.
All right. Carbon dioxide is different. And I want this whole thing.
Carbon dioxide is transported in the blood in three ways.
Number one, dissolved in the plasma of the blood, and it's measured as a PCO2.
So one of the ways that carbon dioxide is transported in the blood is dissolved in the plasma, PCO2.
And normal PCO2 is 35 to 45 millimeters of mercury.
You got me?
So watch. Watch.
The PO2 of our arterial blood is 40. We'll take the middle portion. The PCO2 inside the cell, because that's a byproduct of metabolism, is 45. So PCO2, by pressure, is going to go into the venous blood.
Are you with me, guys? How many people are with me?
So one of the ways the PCO2, our carbon dioxide, is transported in the blood is dissolved in the plasma. The other way is bound to the amino group on hemoglobin.
People used to think that carbon dioxide and oxygen competed for the iron.
Carbon dioxide binds the amino group on hemoglobin. It's called carbaminohemoglobin. Are you with me? That's the second way.
But the third way, and about 70-75% of carbon dioxide is transported in this way. And I want this whole thing. You got me? Whole thing.
There is a law called the law of electroneutrality.
Remember this law, did I explain it to you?
The number of positively charged particles in the blood has to equal to the number of negative charged particles. Remember that? And then in the cell, same thing. That's not negative.
You got me? Do you remember this?
Okay, so here we go. I want this whole thing.
Reggie? When carbon dioxide from the cell diffuses into the plasma of the blood, that carbon dioxide will diffuse from the plasma through the red blood cell membrane and enter the cytoplasm of the red blood cell. You got me?
What's it mostly made out of?
Wawa.
So as CO2 increases, it's going to combine with water, and it's going to form what's this?
Please get this right. Carbonic acid. And carbonic acid then dissociates into hydrogen ions and bicarbonate ions.
So if the hydrogen ions remain free-floating, what's going to happen to the pH inside that red blood cell?
It's going to go down.
So do you want that pH to drop significantly?
No.
So hemoglobin will actually bind those free-floating hydrogen ions and make them not free-floating.
So what did hemoglobin do to it? It buffered it. Do you follow that?
That's how hemoglobin works, as a chemical buffer. So what do you have left over?
Because the hydrogen got buffered,
you got bicarbonate.
And bicarbonate has a negative charge.
And it's readily diffusible from the plasma of the red blood cell back into the plasma of the blood.
Are you with me?
But to maintain the law of electroneutrality, when the bicarbonate leaves, a fluoride has to enter.
To maintain that law,
that's the chloride shift.
Did you read about that in your book? Renite, did you read about that in your book? You just laughed so happy about not reading the book.
Well, maybe you should go back and read it.
Okay. Say yeah. You got me. All right, watch.
This blood is now venous blood.
Where do all the veins of the body dump their venous blood?
Please get this right. The right side of the heart.
And then it gets pumped where?
Renite, if you get this right, don't say anything. She gets it right. I'm going to take a question, and I'm going to tell you the question I'm taking off.
If you get it right.
I don't know.
Where does it get pumped to? You have 3 seconds to answer. One, two, three. Answer it.
Say it loud.
Yeah, yeah, you got it right.
Aw, you got it right.
Yeah,
yeah,
no,
that's all you care about.
I'm in class right now educating.
Yes.
What are you going to do for everybody since you're interrupting?
This is what I'm going to do. Listen up.
You got me?
The pulmonary function test question?
Better listen up.
You're going to do that on your own.
You got me, you're going to learn about that.
On your own. And when you write the quiz,
you follow me?
You're listening.
You will write out the answer to pulmonary function question.
You got me?
And I will grade that separately as a quiz.
Do you follow that?
Do you understand that?
Right?
And if you do well on that, that's good for you.
If you don't do well on it, I'll just drop it
like it never existed.
Do you follow that?
No questions.
I'm helping you out.
I will drop it individually. Like if you don't do it, I'm assuming you probably didn't want that zero added to your grade.
Say yeah.
Is that fair?
It's insanely fair.
Again.
Kimmy comes through.
What do you think?
There you have it.
You got me?
One or 16? What's one?
I'm talking about 16.
There you go.
You're going to figure that out.
Do you understand?
If you want to, because I'm cool like that, and I figure I ain't going to see it.
Not now, anyways.
You can send me what you think is your answer.
And I'll say,
no.
Or, yeah, but you need some work.
Tell me you got that.
You follow?
And because I like you guys, as far as you know.
I'm going to help you right now.
Better write this down.
I don't even know why I do this because all this does is make more work for me. Yeah, more like a boil on my... I'll give people extra credit too if they're willing to sit in that chair back there for one whole class.
They're not.
That's one second.
VOL means volume.
In order to get full credit, in your answer, you will have to define these terms. Tell me you got that. TLC is tender loving care. TLC is total lung capacity. All right? I'm telling you this, right? I can't make it any clearer. Listen. You got me? You're going to write these words. Then you're going to define them. Are you following me? Then you're going to give me the norms for these. Watch. Normal tidal volume is about 500 milliliters. You're going to define tidal volume and then tell me the norms. Say yes. What I'm going to do is I'm going to expect you to learn something on your own. And I'm going to expect, I just want to see what I get. How forced vital capacity, the same thing. Yes? And forced expiratory volume in the first second are related. I want to see what I get. Say yeah.
Got to make sure.
You follow? You're going to learn that on your own.
You following me?
Yes.
How they relate.
You got me? I'm going to give you two pulmonary function curves. And you're going to tell me which one has COPD and why. That's worth the cardiovascular quiz.
It's worth quiz number two.
Say yeah. So you can focus on that.
You with me?
Okay, here we go. It's not worth the respiratory quiz, though.
Going to learn that.
So don't just do this and then forget about the respiratory quiz. Because if you did this good, then I knew you could do the other ones good.
And Tim, you don't like that when you try to scam them.
Because he's trying to help you.
That's number 16.
On the respiratory quiz.
What's that?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
That they're all weighted equally.
Quiz one, quiz two, cardiovascular, they're all the same weight.
You got me?
So if there's one question on the quiz or 30 questions on the quiz, whatever percentage you got is weighted the same.
You got me?
That's why you can take a multiple guess. So don't look at your total points. That doesn't mean anything.
Look at your weighted grade. That's your grade.
Say yeah.
See you never. It's forced expiratory volume in one second.
This forced vital capacity, the term is used interchangeably.
Okay?
Say yes.
You got me?
All right.
So let's move on.
We were interrupted several times there, and I don't even know where we are.
We're talking about oxygen, ain't we?
No, CO2.
Here we go.
Oh, and you got it right.
Now I got a phone up here.
I'm going to sing. I like that. She's working that back.
He was probably watching that.
And slow motion.
Whee!
Actually, looking for stuff on the floor and stuff.
That's how I...
No, I cleaned it.
I got that industrial strength disinfected.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, I got an alibi.
I wasn't here. You'd have to be a forget it and I'm done.
Tell me you got that. You follow this.
All right.
Okay, watch.
This blood is now venous blood.
And all venous blood gets dumped into the right side of the heart and then goes to the lungs.
Per Renite.
Say yeah.
Watch.
As CO2 from the plasma diffuses into the alveoli.
Are you following me?
Bicarbonate from the plasma moves back into the red blood cell.
Are you with me?
Chloride then shifts out.
Bicarbonate's a base, so what happens to the pH inside the red blood cell when you add base?
It becomes goes up.
That's going to cause the hydrogen ion that was bound to the hemoglobin to combine with the bicarbonate, form carbonic acid.
And in the presence of carbonic anhydrase, it's going to break down the CO2 at Wawa, and the CO2 goes, whee!
Say yeah.
And by changing the pH, you change the shape of hemoglobin, and the CO2 that was bound to that amino group breaks off,
and you get rid of that CO2.
That's how CO2 is handled in your body.
Say yes.
Totally with me.
You're going to learn that. You're going to love it.
Who's got the first?
I got to stop that. I'm making life way too easy.
Okay.
Listen to me. I'm telling you this right now.
You are going to watch that video,
and then on Monday,
I'm going to go over it first thing in class.
You got me?
On the oxyhemoglobin association curve.
You follow?
You watch that, and then I'll go over it again in class.
Because you'll have no idea what I'm... Anyone look at that video?
No. Okay.
Well, we're on a roll then. 100%.
I explained to you number six, right?
What is PO2? What is PCO2?
How do PO2 and PCO2 levels affect hemoglobin saturation? Did I explain that to you?
Yes, I did.
And from a clinical perspective, why is PO2 important to delivering oxygen to the cells? I explained that to you, didn't I?
Did I?
Yes or no?
Oh, you weren't here.
Did I explain why PO2 delivers?
I know I did.
I know I did.
Watch.
Listen. I'm going to explain it again because it's important.
If somebody comes into your emergency room and they're bleeding their own blood, Can you look at that blood and say that's A negative all day?
No.
Right?
I did explain that, didn't I?
See, that's how you remember.
That's how you remember.
Right?
But we learned that oxygen, another way oxygen can be transported in the blood, is what?
Dissolved in the plasma.
And what is plasma mostly?
0.9%
sodium chloride.
Or normal saline.
So you start big old IVs on them.
You flood them with fluid.
You give them 100% oxygen.
You can transport oxygen dissolved in the plasma.
Say yeah.
Until you can type and cross-match that blood.
Do you know what cross-matching is?
What's cross-matching?
You heard on ER, lifetime in ER.
Type cross-match for six units.
Do you know what that means?
What's the cross match?
Say what?
Guys, I'm making stuff up now.
They type the blood.
You got me?
Watch.
You're going to learn stuff.
They find out they type the blood and the recipient's blood is A negative.
You got me?
So they're going to find donor blood in the blood bank.
That's A negative.
They typed it.
Say yeah.
Then what they do is they take a little bit of the recipient's blood
and a little bit of the donor blood.
And they mix it together to see if there is a reaction.
That's
the cross match.
And if there is, even though that's type A blood, A negative blood, you can't give it to them because the person's going to die.
They're going to die from...
That's so appropriate.
It's called disseminated intravascular coagulation.
They will clot and then use up all their blood clotting factors and they will bleed to death.
Death will happen.
What's that?
They take another donor A negative and mix it.
So that's the cross match.
Say yes.
You got it.
See, you learned that microbiology.
Who had microbiology?
Anybody?
Did you learn that microbiology?
You don't remember?
That was a blur, huh?
All right, here we go.
Number seven, I explained to you why the PO2 in the atmosphere is higher than the PO2 in the alveoli.
Explain how increasing or decreasing ventilation affects pH of the blood. Did I explain that to you?
Did I, yes or no?
Do you remember?
I can explain it in two seconds.
So I'm going to explain it now in two seconds.
What's that?
Is this yours?
I ain't telling you.
Where's yours?
Number eight.
Why do we breathe?
That's a matter of fact.
You just be okay, that was good.
It ain't right.
Why do you breathe?
Lord.
It's indirectly CO2, but it's directly what?
Oh.
I'll just tell you.
It's indirectly CO2.
Tell me, watch.
I'm going to run from that guy.
Because you never know.
So you start running and using muscle.
Yes?
So to make a muscle contract, you need ATP.
That hack off their phosphate, build up ADP.
The muscle cells start, enzymes are working faster to break down glucose and fat to pop on their phosphate.
And you produce carbon dioxide, heat, hydrogen dioxide, CO2, at Wawa.
Say yeah.
The CO2 from the muscle cell diffuses into the blood. It diffuses or circulates to the medulla oblongata.
It goes from the blood into the cerebral spinal fluid,
combined with water, dissociates into hydrogen by carbon ions, and the hydrogen ions stimulate the medulla to send a signal down the frenulum to contract the diaphragm.
So we breathe.
Due to control levels of carbon dioxide.
Say yeah.
What is CO2?
It's an acid.
That's probably the best thing you could ever learn in this class.
And the red blood cells live 120 days.
CO2 is an acid. So if you are hypoventilating,
you're not breathing as much as you should.
And you're not removing carbon dioxide.
What's going to happen to the pH of your blood?
It's going to go down.
Tell me you got that.
And what does an acidosis do to neural activity?
It suppresses it.
So if people don't breathe very good, they go into a coma.
If you go on WebAdvisor and you see your final grade,
and you are grief-stricken, and you start hyperventilating,
you are blowing off more carbon dioxide than you are producing.
So you are getting rid of acid.
So what's going to happen to your pH?
It's going to go up.
And what does an alkalosis do to neural activity?
It stimulates it.
So you'll start getting numbness and tingling.
Tell me you got that.
And you can seize.
Say yeah.
You see how this all relates? That relates to quiz number one and calcium.
See, I'm relating everything.
Did you follow that?
What do you do if somebody's hyperventilating?
Right. I've been told to wear a bag, but not to breathe in one.
Did you get it?
Do you know what a wolf date is?
A wolf date?
You're drunk as a guy and you pick up a girl. And then you wake up in the morning and you're sober.
And you look at her and she's laying on your arm.
Instead of waking her up, you shoot her.
Can I tell you about my human church for a minute?
Listen to him.
Just watch.
Take five minutes.
You don't want to update your Facebook status.
He's living with my sister for free.
Do you understand that?
He's living down in the basement of my mom's house. My sister lives there. And then my brother has cerebral palsy.
So Saturday was a nice day. So I went over and cleaned my sister's yard.
He couldn't help me because he was taking his new girlfriend. On a motorcycle ride.
Of course, that could not wait.
Couldn't wait.
So anyways, Sunday my brother had a couple of teeth pulled and he had a tooth cap, so I went over to check on him and make sure he was okay.
And my human turd comes up from the basement at 2 o'clock in the afternoon,
having relations with his girlfriend.
Yeah.
He's got a big fat gut and a lazy eye. And I'm like, this girl has to be blind, man.
But anyways, I digress.
So I'm looking at my brother and then he comes up and he says, Oh, I'm getting $1,500 back from the month.
The income tax.
And my sister, right?
And I said, hey, it'd be nice if you gave Lori some of that.
Well, I got bills to pay.
I got bills. You live for free.
Well, I got to buy a boat.
This is a guy who has a motorcycle, a truck, a van, a car.
More guitars and instruments that I've literally ever seen in my life.
Has no job and no money. And he's going to buy a boat with his income tax money.
He worked for six months.
Yeah.
That's a record for him, by the way.
Watch. He's an idiot. He's an idiot.
But watch.
Do you understand this?
Look at this.
He's living for free.
And he wants to take that money and buy a boat with it.
I said, there's something wrong with you.
There is.
There's something wrong with you.
And he thinks that I'm insane. How can you not see it?
That this is my money and I should be able to do whatever I want with it.
Guess what, though?
Here's the thing.
He ain't the only one like that out there.
Cup runneth over.
Don't it?
Cup runneth over with guys like that.
Woo!
Here's the thing.
You know what he did?
This guy is wonderful.
He's a turd.
I told him one time, I said, I'm going to see corn growing out of you pretty soon.
Right?
You know how you see corn in your crap?
That's going to be you.
And I said, you stink.
I went down by the basement and I go, what the hell is that?
It smells like ass. You know what I'm talking about, right?
What the hell is that?
He hasn't taken a shower in a month.
I am not lying.
My brother wears diapers, right?
So he craps.
Yeah, you know,
and diapers sometimes the house smells like crap, right?
That's different.
B
BO is different.
You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yep.
And it's right, right on like, it's unbelievable.
And here's the thing. He finds
women.
Can I tell you?
I mean, honestly.
You know what?
It's just disgusting. Here's the thing.
Look.
You should meet him sometime.
You should meet him.
No,
because watch. He thinks he's wonderful.
Just ask him.
Yeah, he's wonderful.
He says to me one time,
I eat stuff. It just doesn't stick.
I go, it's got to be sticking somewhere.
It's got to be sticking.
Because I go, and how many months pregnant are you now?
Is it 97 months pregnant?
Yeah.
This is no joke.
If family gets together, he puts his plate on his lip.
We had to finally tell him, and my mom told him, you have to eat last. You have to eat last. Because you will go there and no disregard for anyone and just start grabbing whatever's there and just start throwing it into his mouth. I have never seen a human being eat so much so quickly.
I go, Do you have to count your fingers? Right? Sometimes you never know.
Right?
Find a piece of his toenail in there, right?
It's just disgusting.
And he belches all the time.
What makes you feel better?
And then he had a mild heart attack from an overdose of crack cocaine he smoked.
No.
But he thinks that because he doesn't drink or drug no more.
I'm wonderful.
Look at me.
I said, how come my kids don't clap at me when I come home?
I don't drink or drug.
How come my kids don't do that?
I said, you don't get credit for what you're supposed to be doing.
You weren't supposed to be smoking and drinking anyways.
Yes, stupid idiots.
Yeah.
I told him one time, I said, The only thing you have done right in your entire life is you haven't appropriated.
No, right?
Maybe with the crazy one, right?
And watch.
They never picked him up so his head was smashed on one side.
I go, he needs a helmet.
He needs a helmet.
You know how much that is?
I said, watch.
If my kid needed a helmet and I didn't have any money, I'd be in downtown with Senior Notion.
Hey, my little PC Timmy.
I would prostitute myself to make sure that my kid got a helmet.
What does he do?
I go, so you go, right, for his own child.
For his own child.
Yeah, he got a helmet.
You know who got a helmet?
Because my sister, who's his grandmother, says,
he looks like Bozo from the back.
His head was smashed in.
And I said, watch.
Wait, turn on the side.
Holding a child.
I should write that down.
You should have an IQ test to be a parent.
Right?
That guy is...
He's not... He's retarded.
He's not retarded. I take that back. He is a complete and total sociopath and narcissist.
And if that's your parent, you're in trouble. What's that?
You don't realize that you like that?
Right, well, I've told him a million times, right?
Yeah, okay, that's another excuse he can use.
Right, so what he should do is he could go someplace and dig a hole and just jump in and pour the dirt on himself. And you know what?
Being an isolated incident, there are tons of guys out there just like that.
And it sickens me.
So you know what I'm going to do? I ain't never dating that guy.
I would hate to be a young woman now. I feel bad for you.
I really do.
I absolutely do.
Right?
First of all, they're not men. They're more feminine than I've ever seen guys before.
It takes longer for them to get ready than it does with women.
What's up with that?
Yeah, you heard.
Vocabulary.
Get it?
Word.
Yeah. All right, I did that one. How do we get on that?
I'm going to have to edit T.
Ooh, that was running, huh?
I'll edit it, don't worry. It'll be up in a couple of days. Don't you worry about me studying that anyways.
No, here we go.
What golf club did Tim threaten to kill his
dad? He's an idiot. If you can guess the question, I'm going over. I will give you a swig of my Diet Mountain Dew and these headphones.
No.
What is this?
And what's that?
That's glucose.
And there's a lot of it, right?
Wow.
You got it? Number nine.
Number nine.
Ready?
What's DK?
Good.
Do they have insulin or no insulin?
Good. No insulin, or they are diabetic and real sick.
Because what happens when you're sick?
Excuse me. Sound like my nephew.
He texts me all the time.
Two of them just beat. What should I do? What is it?
I go, I don't know.
And then I go, I think you have a hiatal hernia. So he goes to the emergency room all the time, and they gave him this diagnosis.
Xiphoid phasia.
You get xiphoid pain when you eat.
I go, he shows me that.
I didn't tell him, but I go, that's totally made up. They wanted him to get out of their emergency room.
Right.
Because he doesn't have any insurance.
So that's what you got.
Yeah.
What's the treatment for that?
Just eat slowly.
Can I tell you, losers have the most fun in life.
They really do. Right?
I'm out there cleaning my mom's yard, right?
Right, raking, getting blisters on my palm.
Maybe get a blister on my little finger.
That's it.
No, the song from the...
Oh.
You were thinking of my little juice, didn't you?
Where was I going with that? Oh, they do, right?
What's he doing? I'm out there cleaning my mom's yard. He's out there with his new girlfriend riding his motorcycle. Did I tell you the story about my motorcycle that I was going to give him?
You want to hear that story? This is a true story.
It's just sickening.
It is absolutely sickening.
Here's the thing, too.
I turned it on just as you were saying that.
No, but watch. He doesn't work. But they still put him in daycare.
No. His girl, she's got a really good job. She works for Associates. Really good job.
She wants him to interact with other kids. They don't want to watch him.
He's three.
No, my human turd doesn't want to do that.
He doesn't want to do that.
No, he doesn't know how to do it.
He's an idiot. Yeah, I agree with that. I go.
And you see a kid, right? His dad sits on his ass all day.
Yeah, that's what I want to do when I grow up.
I want to be fat, lazy, and watch TV all day.
Yeah, watch.
He has an 80-inch screen TV down in the basement in his bedroom.
And he has a 60-inch screen in the little living room that he made.
How?
He told me one time he wanted to go golf.
Oh, yeah, I do.
She bought me some. Xbox, PlayStation,
the whole nine yards.
I asked her one time.
I said, is it that bad?
She goes, is it that bad being by yourself?
You wouldn't put up with a human turd like that.
And you know what she did? She looked at me very matter of fact.
Yes, I said, okay.
But I want you to know, you now have informed consent.
I'm telling you that he will bankrupt you financially and emotionally, and he will walk away and not think twice about it.
So of course, he did exactly what I said he was doing, and I see her in the driveway one time, and she's talking to my mom. I said, Michelle, come here, come on, grab it. Don't ever come over here again, you understand? I told you what you were going to get, that's what you got, and that's what you deserve.
Because you were an idiot.
And it's not like you met him at a bar, you had sex, and you got pregnant.
You knew what the guy was like for a year and a half.
You said, I'm going to have a baby with this guy.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
You know why?
Let me tell you something.
One thing I hate is people who want something for nothing. I hate it. I despise it.
And that's what he wants. He wants something for nothing.
And he wants to take advantage of people, and I hate that.
I may have hurt people, but I've never done it, say, I'm going to do this to this person,
and it's really going to jack them up.
I have made errors of omission, not commission.
He thinks in his head, what can I get?
You know what he was talking to my nephew about when my sister dies,
who's going to take her house?
Swear to you.
No.
No.
He's self-absorbed.
He was in a car accident and was 17 and got brain damage.
He would have been worse.
No joke.
All right, let's get on with this.
How do we get on that?
No more human turd talk.
That could be a radio show.
Talk to Jimmy.
You got a turd for a boyfriend or a husband?
Get a face.
Yeah.
But you know I'm right. You know I'm right.
Right? One thing I have to say about my ex-wife, she married right. Right?
When we got divorced, she got everything.
Everything.
House.
$400,000 in the bank.
Right? Everything.
You know what my mom always brings up?
She never gave me any sheets or towels.
Like, Ma, she took everything.
She always used to bring that up.
And it was the same every time. Never gave us sheets or towels.
She took $400,000 out of the bank and socks in some place.
And I wouldn't fight for that.
Because my peace of mind is worth a lot of money.
It was worth all of my money.
And if I had to do it all over again,
I'd make that same one.
What's that?
No, when we were going through a divorce,
she handled the money, right?
So she knew where it was, and she took it all and put it in another account.
I would never...
Yeah, I didn't care.
I had my car, my clothes, and my golf, that was it.
Right?
And this is a true story. I can verify. For the first year and a half that I was working here, my paycheck got directly deposited in her account.
I said, just take care of our child.
Right?
Do whatever you have to do.
I paid $4,500 a month in maintenance and child support for one child.
That's a true story.
Yeah, you can go to any college he's accepted to, except he won't be able to get in good ones because they won't accept him because he's majoring in underachieving.
Here we go.
I'm getting through this.
I'm going over number nine.
My shoulders hurt from yelling.
I'm going over number nine. Watch.
If you don't have insulin and your blood sugar say 1200.
You got me, no insulin.
What does the liver think?
Right.
The liver thinks you're starving, right?
That your brain doesn't have any glucose.
So the liver takes fat and converts it into ketones.
What are the ketones?
Come on.
Right, acetic acid.
Acetone and beta hydroxybutyric acid.
And those get dumped into the blood.
What are you dumping into your blood?
Acid.
And what is the direct stimulus of the medulla?
Hydrogen ion. Tell me you got that.
So watch.
That's why.
You know, it's a lot of work I figured out. Looking over your answers and then reviewing them. So I have to grade your test like twice. You know, once you write it out in class and once you're right.
That's a lot of work.
Yeah.
See how nice I am?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like the wife that never gets any credit for doing anything.
I'm really abused in this relationship.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You can stuff your sorries in a sock, mister.
I hate you too, Susie.
Oh, here we go.
This is a lady who's small breathing.
The reason I bring this up is I also figured out that is probably what is going on with you guys.
When I look out at you and I see them.
You must be a DK.
That's not a good one, but it makes a good point.
So this is a better one.
So watch.
Now watch.
What are you making at the cell?
What are you making at the cell?
So in order for you to maintain pH, if you're making acid at the cell, what do the lungs have to do?
They have to get rid of more acid by blowing off more CO2.
That is why you breathe faster and deeper when you're in DKA.
Do you got that?
That's called Kussmaul breathing. It's an attempt to maintain your pH. Do you see that?
See how this all relates? See how it all comes together?
And then there's something else.
And then, look. Look at her ears.
Yeah, she's got earrings too.
I think because she was probably...
What do hydrogen ions do to blood vessels?
What's that? Do you see that? Right?
You're in acidosis, so your pH got more free floating hydrogen ions or vasodilators. That's why their blood pressure tends to be low. See how this all relates?
Yeah, her blood pressure was 126 over 80. It was 210 over 20.
Yeah, like a lot.
There you go.
Explain in detail the reasons for increased ventilation in a patient with DKA.
Okay. All right, we're doing real good.
All right, watch.
Did I explain chronic bronchitis to you?
Okay, here we go.
The one that says chronic bronchitis?
Number 12.
Oh.
I'm sorry.
I take that back.
On your quiz, write minus 15.
That's how it works?
Okay, hang on.
Now I'm all...
My sister texts me and I was talking to her and she's like, you can have a heart attack. You need to relax.
You know, that just irritates me when people want something for nothing.
And when people take advantage of other people, I hate that.
Well, some turds find it.
Some turds find it.
Okay, here we go.
That's why I hate people.
I would never do that.
I could never do that to somebody.
Okay, here we go. I want this whole thing.
Cigarette smoking causes two things: it causes paralysis of cilia and goblet cell hypertrophy. They get bigger.
What do goblet cells produce?
Mucus.
So they have increased mucus production, but they can't move it.
So the only way to clean their lungs is to plunge their lungs.
You know what I'm talking about, right? Real wet, nasty cough.
And then their face starts turning red and you think they're going to die.
You know what I'm talking about, yes?
Okay, so watch.
And chronic bronchitis is inflammation of the bronchi and bronchioles.
Are you following me?
So this is what happens.
Did I tell you about the lady that came in?
You know what a refrigerator nurse is?
Did I explain to you what happened when this lady came in with chronic bronchitis?
I didn't explain this to you?
Anyways, she came in and she was having shortness of breath. So the refrigerator nurse put her on six liters of oxygen.
And I'm taking care of someone else. So I walk past the room.
And then all of a sudden I see her like this, she's unconscious. And she's gone.
And she's breathing.
I timed it.
Three times a minute.
And I go,
That ain't right.
So I look at her chart real quick. Chronic bronchitis times 20 years. I run in, I look at the oxygen, it's like 6 liters. I turn it down to 2 liters, and lo and behold, she wakes up.
Right, you know why?
Oh, you watch that video?
Man, I'm proud of you. Too bad you didn't get anything out of it.
I know, right?
I apologize.
That's wrong of me.
I was proud of you.
Darn it.
You know what, that's mean. Look, you took time out of your busy schedule to get your hair and nails done, and you read and watched that video.
Oh, that's nice.
Well, guess what?
Just like my human nephew, you don't get credit for what you're supposed to do.
Write that down.
I hate me too.
Right, watch.
In chronic bronchitis, these are the bronchioles, and they become blocked with mucus.
Are you following?
So when that person takes oxygen in, are they going to be able to get any oxygen into the cell?
No.
But here's the problem. In people with chronic bronchitis, there is a ventilation.
Perfusion, blood flow mismatch.
You will still perfuse these alveoli, but you will not ventilate them. So will this blood that's high in CO2 and low in oxygen participate in gas exchange in this alveoli?
Will it?
Say no.
Good, because that's a mucus block.
Tell me you got that.
So will this alveoli be able to get rid of the CO2 and take on oxygen?
So the oxygen in the air is going to go here, and this alveoli will be able to get rid of CO2 and take on oxygen.
Where does all of that newly oxygenated blood dump into?
What part of the heart?
The left side of the heart.
So what's going to happen to the amount of CO2 and the amount of O2 in a person's blood that has chronic bronchitis?
What's going to happen to their CO2 levels?
They will have high CO2 levels and low PO2 and O2 saturation.
Tell me you got that.
So what happens to these people over time?
Over time, the medulla becomes desensitized to that high levels of carbon dioxide.
So these people no longer breathe because of elevated carbon dioxide.
They breathe because of low levels of oxygen.
Say yeah.
Now watch.
This is where it comes.
This is where it comes together.
Are you watching?
Who's watching?
Maybe it's not on here.
Well, it better be.
Well, I got an explanation of cystic fibrosis on here.
Damn. That's good.
Wait, here it is.
Watch it.
Who's watching?
There's Tiger Woods with pneumonia.
Here it is.
Better write this down.
Because this goes with number two.
It goes with number two and number 12.
See how all the questions are related? You should see it at this point.
Do you?
Watch.
Who's watching?
In the arch of the aorta. And in the carotid arteries,
you have these chemoreceptors.
You got me?
And these chemoreceptors in people with chronic bronchitis are able to detect, they sense low PO2 and low oxygen saturation.
And when they sense low
PO2 and low oxygen saturation, these chemoreceptors feed back on the medulla and tell you to breathe
faster and deeper.
The peripheral chemoreceptors in people with chronic bronchitis
respond to decrease in O2. The central chemoreceptor becomes desensitized to high levels of carbon dioxide because they're always exposed to high levels of carbon dioxide.
Do you see this?
So if you give a patient with chronic bronchitis high levels of oxygen,
their stimulus to breathe is low levels of oxygen.
So if you elevate their PO2 and their oxygen saturation, you take away their stimulus to breathe, and they'll stop breathing.
Do you understand that?
That's why you don't give a patient with chronic bronchitis high levels of oxygen.
Bronchitis is a form of COPD. In people with emphysema, it's different. They're still able to maintain their CO2 levels, so they breathe because of the buildup of CO2. So you can have higher levels of oxygen in people with emphysema. If you take my pathophysiology class, I will explain to you in detail the differences between chronic bronchitis and emphysema and the clinical manifestations that are associated with it.
That sounds like a good commercial, huh?
Say yeah. Tell me you followed that.
Right?
Now watch. You don't know this yet. Well, maybe you do.
One of the things that the kidney does is it senses drops in PO2 and oxygen saturation. You following?
So if you have chronic bronchitis,
does your kidneys know you have chronic bronchitis?
No.
All they know is that you don't have enough oxygen. And the kidney releases the hormone called erythropoietin, and it will cause people with chronic bronchitis to make more red blood cells. Are you following?
The kidney thinks your oxygen saturation is low because you don't have enough red blood cells.
When in fact, it's a lung issue. So these people can't even saturate the red blood cells they have,
and now more are being formed.
That's why they develop cyanosis.
So people with chronic bronchitis are actually encouraged to donate blood to reduce their red blood cell count because if it gets too high, the blood will actually clot.
So they can develop clots because of COPD. Say yeah.
All right, take a break. We did not good at all.
No more stories getting through this. Say yeah. All right.
I'm telling you, look, you've got to go over that oxyhemoglobin association curve for Monday.
Please. Guys, you've got to go over it. All right? Saturday, I'm coming in. I can't do Friday. Saturday, I'll come in. Okay?
9 o'clock, but it's here.
Yeah? Well, I'm going to come in every Saturday until the end of the semester.
You got me?
Here.
Right?
I'm going to have my general students working in the lab from 9 until 10, 9 to 10:30. So I'll work with you guys and then they're done, they come in and ask questions.
But every Saturday until the end of the semester, you follow? I don't want to make excuses.
So I'll be here Saturday too, and I'm telling you right now, you better go over that video.
That question right there is going to be on there, and it's for 350 big ones, no little ones.
Right?
You're going to have to know that.
Do you understand? I'm telling you that right now.
Okay.
Because why do you do that?
I go, she was really good to me when I needed someone to be good at me.
Well, you paid her back a hundred times fold.
I said, that's your opinion.
I said, why wouldn't I go?
Of course you wouldn't.
That's why you're a human turd.
Yes.
Because he is.
And he doesn't care, right?
Because if you don't have to work and you can get up whenever you want, you put up with that.
That's why he finds these women, they'll bitch at him for a while.
But he's like, that's my job.
My job is to listen to that whining and bitching, but she'll shut up after a while, and I can do whatever I want.
And that's what he does.
He's a turd.
He'll get his.
Okay, here we go.
I did that.
Watch.
I'm going to go over tension pneumothorax. Tell me you got that. This is a good one.
You're going to know after this. So I'm definitely not going to go over it.
You can learn clinical. Yeah, you heard me. In the words of my old man,
those ears painted on your head.
Okay, ready? Who's ready?
Okay, watch.
What's the space between the lungs and the ribs called?
You said.
What's this space right here called?
No, that's in between the cell and blood.
There you go.
It's called the pleural space.
You said that?
Yeah, I'm sure you did.
Watch.
There is negative pressure in the pleural space.
This negative pressure prevents you from blowing out all of the air in your lungs.
It prevents your lungs from collapsing.
And when you blow out all the air in your lungs that you possibly can,
there's a volume left over in your lungs.
That volume, after you blow out all the air that you can, is called your residual volume.
I just gave you the definition.
You look back there.
That's right.
Yeah, and I ain't saying it again.
Are you ready?
Now watch. I also explained to you, and this is very important, that the visceral pleura and the parietal pleura, better get this, of both lungs are separate.
Didn't I tell you that?
I'll never forget that.
So watch.
How many holes do you breathe out of?
Three.
Two nostrils and a mouth.
Say yeah.
Somebody don't like you. So they take a knife and stab it into your chest.
Say yeah.
If they pull that knife out, how many holes do you breathe out of now?
Four.
Now watch.
Watch, you got a hole because somebody stabbed you with a knife.
When you take a breath in, does it get bigger or smaller? So watch. When you take a breath in, because you have a hole here.
When you take a breath in, that hole gets bigger.
So air gets sucked into the pleural space.
Tell me you got that.
What happens to the distance between the ribs when you blow the breath out?
It gets smaller.
So when you blow the breath out, the hole closes off.
So it's like a roach motel. The air gets in, but it can't get out.
And with each breath you take...
I'm watching you.
Did you catch that?
With each breath you take in, you will begin to compress your lungs.
Tell me, because the air can't escape.
That's the tension.
Tell me you got that.
When you breathe in, the air gets sucked into the pleural space, but it can't get out because the hole gets smaller, it gets cut off.
So every time you take a breath in, more and more air is going to accumulate in that pleural space, and it will crush your lungs.
And you will get a tension pneumothorax.
Say yeah. The treatment for tension pneumothorax, watch it.
Who's watching?
And when you have people that have trauma,
and you don't know the level of their trauma, you cannot sedate them. Because you don't know what's going on.
So you got to stick a test tube in them, and those test tubes are about this big, and you're putting them in that pleural space,
and these people are screaming.
I told you about the guys that shot each other.
Nineteen eighty-eight, Dallas, Texas. You didn't even work in our plant. Our guy sat underneath Sunday night, called Night Gun Club. Two guys had shot each other, one in the belly, one in the chest. And the guy we were working with, the chest tube, and he's screaming. And he's reaching for his boot. And I'm like, what the hell is he reaching for his boot? We're trying to stick him in there. There's a sheriff's deputy, right?
So he reaches for his boot because the other guy in the other circle bed, he's trying to shoot again. So he grabs his gun, and then the sheriff's deputy takes his gun and blows a hole right in his chest, kills him. Blood spatters all over us. And I looked at the deputy and I go, we were trying to help this guy. And he is a big, other guy. He posed a threat to you. I go, I guess you're right. And they shot him dead right there.
Yeah.
But they didn't have metal detectors and stuff back then.
Right. Did I tell you a story about the lady that came in and got beat up by her boyfriend?
I'm doing triage, you know what that is?
Come in and say, you're really sick, you go in, you're not sick, you sit over there.
Lady comes in, carried by two guys, right?
I go, what happened?
Her boyfriend beat her up.
I go, where's her boyfriend?
We don't know.
So I said, bring her back. She was all cut up, face all swung, had to do an X-ray of her jaw.
He beat her up bad. So we had to just pull curtains, and they called the cops. They were on their way.
And then this guy comes in, I go, who are you? I'm the boyfriend.
And I went, bam. And I hit that guy.
And I'll tell you, when you watch fights, If somebody gets hit right, they don't get up.
And that guy did not get up.
And he went down and hit that hard tile floor.
And he hit his head. And I'm like, I'm going to prison and I'm losing my license.
Because the cop saw him hit that ground, right?
And I go, I'm going to prison.
And he goes, I haven't seen anything.
They had to take that guy for a CAT scan.
Oh my God, I hit that guy.
I did not get in trouble.
This is 1987.
No, I did not get in any trouble.
I thought because the cop saw it, right? That I'm going to prison, right?
And he's like, I didn't see anything.
But I've been in fights before, but it was kind of a sucker punch. He didn't know it was coming, but man, I hit him perfect. That was the best punch I ever threw in my life.
Huh? Yeah.
Right? And they go down, man. And when they go down, it's like,
If you've heard dead weight, right? It's like miserable.
It's a really sick guttural sound.
He hits his head, you start like, I'm like, that ain't good.
But yeah.
Here's the thing, though.
For the most part, any man can beat up any woman.
They can't, right?
You know, you got a couple rounds of rousey, right?
But watch. It takes guts to stand up to a guy who's just as big as you.
Because you don't know if you get your ass kicked.
Right?
And I've been in many fights, right?
And I've lost a few. Right? But look, you didn't know.
But a woman, yeah.
And that ain't right.
A coward does that, right?
I'm just saying.
I've never hit a woman. When I was 10 years old, I hit my sister, my own man, beat my ass. Like, you will not believe the ass whooping I got.
And that was instilled in me.
You hit a woman, it will be bad for you.
I wouldn't do that anyways.
Unless she hit my golf clubs or didn't find me the right golf balls.
Right. Okay. Tension pneumothorax, did I do that?
Why is this fatal? Why can't it be fatal?
You got another lung, darn it.
People can live with one lung.
What's in between your two lungs? Please get this right.
We just got done talking about it.
And you wonder, you can see my frustration.
When the lung collapses, if it gets bad enough, you'll begin to put pressure on the heart. And it will compress the heart. And you get a condition called cardiac hampa. That's what kills you.
So that's why it's really bad. You have to do that needle compression and get the chest to reinflate that lung.
Now watch.
If you have someone come on whatever cases, they have a knife sticking in them, watch.
You don't cut butter or bread like this.
Right?
You cut it like...
So the knife cuts both ways.
So when the knife is in there and then you pull it out,
you'll be cutting stuff too.
So what you do is... You secure that good fatty acid, try to seal up that hole and get the fatty acid to the emergency room. You don't pull on that stuff out. If the hole is there, you put your finger in or put something in so that the air is getting sucked in with each breath.
Tell me you got there.
If you ever take a first aid course, you'll make one way out for that. In the meantime, have a salve.
Put the finger in it while you're making a little one way out.
So you learn about this if you ever work in an emergency room.
Anybody want to work in an emergency room?
It's crazy.
If you work at a county hospital, a level one trauma center like I did.
I had my hand in a guy's chest, squishing his heart on the way to the emergency room.
Or the way to the OR.
That guy got shot in the chest. They blew up his aorta, right?
So I'm holding his aorta, and I'm squishing his heart.
Yeah, and then the ER surgeon goes,
Do you ever massage anybody's heart?
Yeah, every Tuesday I'm in the club.
He goes, get a serum.
He puts his hand in there, right? He goes, look. And I put my hand in there, you feel that? That's his heart squishing.
Okay.
So I'm on top of this, like this guy got his chest and squishing his heart all the way to the ER.
That guy lived.
Did I tell you about the lady who ran her husband over, or the husband ran the lady over with the truck?
Maybe it was her.
Did she have a really foul mouth?
Well,
Well, that's a loving couple.
Ah.
No. No.
This guy ran this lady over with his pickup, and her hair got wrapped underneath the drive shaft. And he thought he had missed her, so he ran back over again. When she came into the ER, she had her hair ripped out of her skull, right? She's bleeding all over the place, and I'm like, I think there's blood coming out. I think there's brains coming out of her ears. And this lady was swearing every word she was cussing.
That lady survived, and like six months later, she was coming out of the hospital, wheeling her out in a wheelchair, right? And I just imagine that guy in the truck just revving his engine, waiting for her one more time.
That's a true story. My sister Kathy,
she publicly humiliates her husband. Calls him a 300-pound man with tits.
Yes. Fat man on Batman.
Yeah.
It's called the cardiac.
One time I had a big house in Grays Lake, right? And this, it was near Christmas. My mom came down. Oh, it's so nice to meet you. Decorated. Burfield come down. That's my sister's husband. Right, Burfy. I'm like, Mom, forget about Bailey's just born. I don't want to do it. No, I'll call Kathy and Burfy. They'll come down. So it's November. It's cold. I'm on ladder. He's on the other, right? Of course, she's in a nice warm van watching, supervising. So she rolls right away. Don't you see my ex-husband? So she rolls up window, and I'm looking, why don't you kill her, man? Why don't you kill her? If you killed her 15 years ago, you would have been free for 15 years, right?
She is, and she gets whatever she wants. Whatever she wants.
What's that? No, that's my sister, Lori. They're cool. My sister, Kathy. Yep.
He does everything.
He's got a jacked up leg. She's got fibromyalgia.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So he gets up and makes her a meal. She doesn't work.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
She don't care.
People, God.
Going through this.
We're getting done with this. I don't care what anybody says.
Asthma.
I want this whole thing.
Asthma, by definition, is an allergy in your respiratory tract. And what's the primary function of the immune system? Please get this right.
Liz, if you get this right,
I'll give you
a bottle of this.
What's the primary function of the immune system?
I'm not even playing.
Do I have a look on my face?
Forget it, you're taking way too much time.
Here we go. The primary function of the immune system is to produce inflammation.
Write that down.
Toy, write that down.
Huh?
Patronizing.
Okay, watch.
What's the primary function of the immune system?
Better write this down.
And inflammation is produced by massive arterial vasodilation.
I explained to you, and I'm sure I did, that the respiratory lining is vascular. It has tons of blood vessels. Are you following me?
Got me?
So...
massive arterial vasal dilation. That's what produces inflammation. There are other things, too. Number one. Part of the immune system are these things called mast cells. And mast cells release a chemical called leukotrienes. Leukotrienes cause bronchial muscle to spasm. Are you with me? So by definition, asthma is an allergy in your respiratory tract. And an allergy is an exaggerated immune response. It's your immune system overreacting to something that it shouldn't overreact to. And what's the primary function of the immune system is to produce what, Liz?
Yeah, that's right. You had your chance and you blew it.
And it primarily occurs in the smaller airways, the bronchioles.
And if you recall, as you move deeper and deeper into the respiratory tract, there's less cartilage.
And when you get down to the bronchioles, the bronchioles are made of muscle.
And what are the two things that muscle can do?
That's right.
What's the goal of the respiratory system?
To what? To reduce inflammation?
Who said that?
What's the goal of the cardiovascular system? So what's the goal of the respiratory system?
I'm just going to tell you.
It's to maintain airflow.
Anything that flows has to follow Ohm's flow law.
Where airflow is equal to airway pressure.
Divided by airway resistance.
What determines airway resistance?
Please get this right.
I heard a couple of things that were sort of half right.
It's the diameter of...
No, she said that was wrong.
The diameter of the bronchioles.
And what are the bronchioles mostly made out of?
And what are the two things a muscle can do?
You're not going to watch it?
In the bronchial muscles that make up the bronchioles.
In those cells that make up those muscle cells, you have receptors.
Yeah.
They're called beta 2 receptors.
What binds to beta receptors?
Epinephrine.
Watch it.
In the lining, you have blood vessels.
Arteries.
Tell me you got that.
You have beta 1 receptors in arteries.
That line your respiratory tract.
What binds to beta receptors?
Epinephrine. Tell me you got that.
Are you with me?
Watch how this all comes together. Timmy's going to bring it all home for you.
Ooh, doggy.
Dude, boy's got my money.
What's an allergy?
It's an exaggerated immune response. What's the primary function of the immune system?
To produce inflammation.
How do you produce inflammation?
When you twist your ankle, what is your ankle do?
It swells because the arteries are supplying area.
I took the multiple guess midterm, got a 62 on it.
That means you guys will really kill it.
No, me.
Okay, watch.
I'm allergic to cats. I see a cat.
Hair cutting. Pet the cat.
Right?
And the cat hairball goes up, and I'm like...
And you get a cat hairball in there.
I'm allergic to it.
Tell me you got that.
So I'm going to get an exaggerated immune response. So what's going to happen?
What's going to happen to the blood vessels that line?
My bronchioles.
They're going to dilate.
And because they dilate, what's going to happen to the size of my bronchioles?
They're going to get smaller.
Tell me you got that.
And normally, in the lower airways, the bronchioles are nice and smooth.
But what are the bronchioles made out of?
Muscle.
So mast cells, in response to that allergy, release chemicals called leukotrienes.
And leukotrienes stimulate smooth muscle in the bronchioles to spasm.
So the bronchioles, the air ain't flowing in a nice layered fashion when these bronchial muscles spasm.
The bronchial wall looks like this, and air will flow turbulently.
And turbulent airflow produces wheezing.
That's why people with asthma wheeze.
See, you got me?
So what do you have on the muscle cells that make up the bronchial wall?
What kind of receptors?
Beta 2.
And on the blood vessels, you have beta 1.
So watch.
You shake it all about, you take a couple hits, you got me, albuterol stimulates beta 2 receptors in the muscular wall of the bronchial, what do you think albuterol will do when it stimulates beta 2 receptors?
Do you think it'll make the muscles contract more, or they will relax?
So when albuterol drug mimics epinephrine finds beta 2, they're going to relax, so the bronchioles open.
And what's going to happen when albuterol finds beta 1 receptors in the blood vessels?
It's going to constrict them.
So the bronchodilation and the constriction of the blood vessels are going to open up that airway.
Say yeah.
So what are the side effects of taking an albuterol inhaler?
Elevated heart rate, shaky, anxious.
Tell me you got that because those drugs that are used to dilate bronchioles mimic epinephrine.
That's how you remember that.
See that?
See how I explain that?
That's good.
What causes the spasm?
Look at the arrow.
The leukotrienes.
There is a drug called Singular.
Have you ever heard of it?
Singular is a drug that prevents mast cells from releasing leukotrienes. It's taken daily.
That's what prevents bronchospasm.
Say yeah.
But the best drugs to take are the illegal ones.
Watch.
What causes this whole mess to begin with? An exaggerated immune response that overreacted.
What suppresses your immune system? What's a big anti-inflammatory?
If this was booze, I'd drink it.
If you hurt your back, Shelly, from lifting the textbook,
what could they give you? Don't say a lever, Napperson, or whatever.
Oh God.
Heroin. They're going to give you a strong anti-inflammatory.
What do you mean all?
No, we've done it.
They're the most powerful anti-inflammatory. Remember cortisol anti-inflammatory? So they'll give you steroids. They will give you steroid inhalers. Say yes. Steroid inhalers don't dilate your bronchioles. They just prevent your immune system from overreacting.
And you got to take about 3 to 4 weeks of inhaled steroids in order to adequately suppress the immune system.
So if your kid has asthma and they're not having a bout of any problems, and they're not taking their albuterol, they still take their Flovent. Are there ads there? Are there Combivent? Because you have to continually take steroids in order to continually suppress the immune system in the bronchioles.
823, and you just got schooled, not only in asthma, but in life.
Write that down. Do you see this?
That's why kids now shouldn't be going into the emergency room every couple of months because their asthma is out of control. You have just been told that if your kid is given steroids, inhalers, they should be taking steroid inhalers all the time, regardless of how they're breathing.
Why would they tell you to rinse your mouth out after you take a steroid inhaler?
What does it do?
What does a steroid do?
Suppresses your immune system, right? So if you don't rinse it out, it will suppress the immune system in the back of your throat, and you'll end up with a fungal infection called thrush.
That's why they tell you to do that. You know who will explain that to you?
In nursing school, they'll just make sure you rinse it out so they don't get an infection in the back of your throat.
They'll never explain why.
Timmy just explained it. Bam. Again, the education of gateway students continues.
Tell me you follow that.
It's not push your nipple. Well, I don't know about yours.
Most look.
Take that back. Just so you know, on your skin, you have 10 times more bacteria than you have cells in your body.
You got me?
So you can scrub a dub, three men in a tub all you want, and you're still going to have a ton of bacteria on there. And they live a nice life with you. Most of the time, they don't bother you.
Say yeah. So you don't bother them.
And the best way to not bother bacteria on your skin is to read the textbook. Tell me you followed this.
You got this.
That's exactly how this stuff works.
You with me?
All right. We'll finish up the rest on Monday. It'll be very simple.
Just so you know. Listen up, because this is true.
Your last quiz will be the respiratory quiz. You got me? The last quiz. Then everything will be on the final. Because we're running out of time. Unless you would like to have a kidney quiz. But listen up.
We'd have to do it either before class or after class.
Or you'd have to do it sometime on your own, so I don't want to take class time to do it. But it would be oral. Do you want to do that?
This is what I'll do.
What you can do is you can take a kidney quiz, right?
If you think you studied that stuff, you know it.
Then you can take a kidney quiz.
If you're happy with your grade, where it is so far, you don't have to take it.
How does that sound?
Right, so this is an opportunity to improve your grade. So if you do well on the kidney quiz, you can drop your lowest quiz.
Say yes.
If you're happy with your grade, you don't have to take it, those questions will still be on the final.
You got me?
Okay.
I'm trying to help you out. You know that, right?
So studying. Help yourselves. Okay, I'll have to, all of her stuff is in there.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Can you make a copy of that for me so I have it next time?